I'm 23 years old. I'm sending you my baldness photo. Am I a good candidate for hair transplant as chances of shock loss are high? In my case, hair needs to be transplanted in between existing hair, so chances of shock loss are high. I'm using minoxidil since 6 months ago to reduce shock loss chances. I'm 23 years old and shock loss makes my look worse. Should I go for transplantation now? And if yes, how many grafts are needed in my case? Thanks in advance.
Thank you for your question. At the age of 23, you're going through a very aggressive pattern of hair loss, and you've submitted some photos that are very helpful. Essentially, your question begins with this concern about shock loss before having while undergoing a hair transplant, and you're using minoxidil to try to prevent that. Well, I think you're on the right path as far as the shock loss concept, but I'm going to actually introduce you to something a little bit different that is not an actual hair transplant, to help you understand why how we do what we do in our practice. First of all, in terms of hair transplantation, for most practices in the field of hair transplant, there is a hesitation about doing transplant on patients as young as yourself. And there's one main reason. When people are losing their hair so quickly, then the desire for volume or the ability to create the volume with the transplant alone is not likely to work out, because when you think about hair loss, when you first notice hair loss, you've already lost about 50% of your hair. Now, the typical number that we use in our field is that at your most, you have 100,000 hairs. And when you are losing hair and you're noticing it, you're now down to 50,000 hairs. Well, by the time you're at a point where you're ready to have a transplant, you have to understand the limitations of the donor area. Now, the donor area is the area in the back of the scalp which is permanent, that is resistant to the genetic effects of male pattern hair loss. So the donor area at a given time can yield somewhere around 1,500 to 2,000 hairs. And although people claim to do mega sessions where they do more than that, 2,500 hairs, it's a significantly lower percentage to cover an area where there's a lot of loss. So in general, being able to move at maximal doing 3 to maybe 4 sessions of hair transplant procedures, you're not going to move more than maybe 10,000 hairs, and that's being very optimistic. In our practice, we have had an opportunity to actually reverse hair thinning and thicken hairs that are thinning using a technique we call hair regeneration. It just so happens that we have learned a lot in the past couple of years about the cells and signals related to hair loss. And if you look at the literature, in medical literature, you can actually see where there is this initial perception where minoxidil and finasteride were the only pharmacologic treatments where dihydrotestosterone or DHT was considered the enemy. And if you took finasteride, you can decrease the enemy that's attacking the hair follicles. But even with finasteride, people would continue to lose hair. And a lot of younger males who would take finasteride would still continue to lose hair very aggressively. So clearly there was another part of the process that remained to be figured out. So initially, over the course of 2 to 3 years, from 2011 or so onward, there are a couple of things that we've learned. One is that the cell layer under the skin, called the fatty cell layer, actually send signals to a part of the hair follicle called the dermal papilla. Now, the dermal papilla then communicates with a part of the hair follicle called the bulge area, where there are cells called progenitor cells. And in studies done at the University of Pennsylvania, showed that the progenitor cells are diminished in men with male pattern hair loss. So serendipitously, a wound healing material called extracellular matrix, which heals by duplication of cells, was discovered to actually reverse thinning of hair. So some of the best discoveries in medicine happen to be by accident. Right now, there are several companies that are biotech companies looking for the magical cure of baldness. And unfortunately, the concept of hair cloning still remains evasive, because the hair follicle is actually very complex. It's, you know, duplicating a hair follicle is like duplicating a kidney. So what we have done over the past couple of years is we have worked on developing a formulation and a method of using extracellular matrix with platelet-rich plasma and other factors, including vitamin D, based on research at the University of Tokyo. And we have been very successful in reversing hair thinning. Now, there is a limit. This is not a perfect solution. It is, however, a tremendous step in the treatment of hair loss and has helped patients who have come to us from all over the world. So what I would do in my practice for someone like yourself is I would not do a transplant first. I would first do the hair regeneration injection, see how much we can reverse. And in so many ways, it appears what we're doing is we're restoring the critical cells that it might be through an injury model that these cells are being restored that are protecting the hair follicle from dihydrotestosterone and restoring the cell cycle that causes the hairs to grow. So essentially, for someone like yourself, I would wait to do a transplant. I would do hair regeneration first, see how much you're able to restore through this treatment, and then if you would still want to have more hair, then we can be very strategic. It's very important when you do a transplant that you're dealing with a limited source of hair. And so when we place these hairs, we want to get the most benefit in terms of coverage and in framing the face. So I realize this is different than what you were initially considering, but I think you should really learn as much as you can about this newer technology. Unfortunately, the hair field has lots and lots of false claims and a lot of hype about a lot of things that don't work, and it feeds on the desperation of people who are losing hair. So learn from this. I would advise that you incorporate this in your decision-making process and then take the appropriate steps to finding the right doctor for you. So I hope that was helpful for you, and thank you for your question.